Pray. Our Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for we can continue and understanding and knowing how we can reach people in the urban setting. Provide us a keen understanding, Lord, and a passion to really work hard in order to reach them out for your honor and glory. As we go on today, as Pastor Fernando deals with a topic towards that direction on urban ministry, we pray that you will guide each one of us, particularly him as he presents the topic. Lord, thank you so much for hearing our prayers. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Pastor Fernando is currently a teacher in the College of Theology, right? He had been a pastor for 13 years in the field and at the same time in teaching ministry for 13 years. So he has already 26 years of service. But more importantly, talking about urban ministry, he worked in Metro Manila, in Bulacan, and in Cavite. And you notice these areas are highly urbanized areas. Although when we look at Cavite, it's not on that highly urbanized setting, but it's in that direction, right? So let's now give the time to Pastor Andresito Fernando.
Good morning. Are you still there? Okay, pa. Okay, because you know, because we started a little bit late, we would like to really make our time enough to cover a lot of topics. You know, I told Pastor Cuneos that I will make my presentation concise because we are almost 11, right? And we are supposed to end this morning because we will have another set of lecture this coming afternoon. And so we would like to do our best to make our presentation concise and brief. Okay, so in this matter. And I am privileged that I have time to share with you the basic of urban ministry principle in the New Testament. Okay, so I would like to appreciate Pastor Ron Hinibago for giving us a very timely lesson of sharing to us the ministry of Daniel in Babylon. My presentation now is all about the ministry of the apostles, especially Apostle Paul in urban areas, so that we could learn something from his strategy, his technique. I'm going to try to do my best to furnish copies for you, maybe this afternoon, because I failed to Xerox the materials, but probably during our lunch break, I will go to the Xerox copy center and Xerox materials for you. Okay, that is my goal after the presentation. It is very encouraging, by the way, that when you talk about urban ministry, the urban ministry is firmly rooted in the teaching of the New Testament. Are you aware of that one? If you're going to scan, to browse the pages of New Testament, you're going to find that the New Testament does not mention only in passing the importance of urban ministry, but on the other hand, the New Testament really affirms and upholds the importance of urban ministry. And what we have in the New Testament is that the New Testament teaches that the ministry and mission of the church is not only for a certain group of people, but we would like to use the word universal, worldwide. And by that sense, we cannot avoid the idea of urban places in that matter. I'm going to share to you some of the well-known biblical passages that mandate the importance of urban ministry. So I have chosen, there are so many, our time is not enough to cover all of them, but we have at least four basic biblical passages that affirm, okay, the importance and our task as urban ministers, you know. Number one is that all of you are aware with the Great Commission, right? Without letter C, we don't like the Great Omission. What we like is the Great Commission, the mandate of Jesus Christ, His church. We also would like to consider briefly the gospel proclamation before the parousia. What is parousia, by the way? It is the second coming, and a parousia means coming, okay? And urban ministry is very much part of the phenomena of gospel commission before the parousia. We also would like to visit the empowerment through the Holy Spirit. I won't deal with this one deeply because Pastor Cuneos will tell us, explore will help us explore the power of the Holy Spirit in the book of Acts. But just by mentioning some, a little bit of it, that one of the most promising fields when the Holy Spirit will empower His church are urban areas. You know? Sometimes we use urban and city interchangeably. So let me cite the thing that I have in mind. Number one is that every time I mention the word city, I refer to geographical place. But urban is an adjective. Okay, adjective. It describes and modifies the condition of the place. Kaya pag sinabing urban, we describe. Okay, but cities are nouns, you know. So, and that's why I use that a little bit interchangeably, but both of them have the same meaning. And then number four is that urban ministry is very much embedded in the proclamation of the what? The three angels' message. That's why that's one of the most important thing, because the three angels' message is the last day message of God's people in the end time. Okay, let's revisit a little bit about the Great Commission. Okay, so maybe let's read together the first part of the Great Commission. So shall we read in chorus? Go therefore, and what? And make disciples of all nations. So I just quoted the very first part of the Great Commission because we believe that this is the lifeblood, the reason of our existence. Do you still remember that a church without mission is what? What kind of church? Huh? A dead church, a dying church. So we must live by our mission. And so we have the Great Commission of Jesus Christ. Now, there's a problem, however, because there are many proposals by many scholars, different proposals, but I think one of them is very dominant, is that the imperative in the verse is what? It has been commonly proposed that the imperative of the verse is make disciples. No? That's why those who are very much eager looking at the Greek structure of the text, they usually point to the word make disciple as the what? The imperative, di ba? So if you're going to check the Greek morphology, yung word forms, you know, you're going to see that the make disciple there is in the verb imperative. However, the word go is in the participle. And so some Bible translators propose that the translation must be, as you go, make disciples. Okay, so that's the common proposal nowadays. However, if you are going to check the revision of the New King James Bible, it retains the word go in the imperative, right? So it doesn't follow the proposed translation of some other scholars, but the King James Version retains the word go as if go is one of the imperatives of the Great Commission. Now, I will tell you a little background about this one, because the translator of the King James Version follows a little bit of a different approach when it translated this Great Commission. Now, one example is that, if my memory is right, a famous New Testament scholar, George Martin, has proposed that to make an accurate translation, morphology is not the only basis, yung word form. Ano? So after analyzing the structure of Matthew 28 as well as the context of Matthew 38, he made the conclusion that even though the word go in Greek is in verbal participle, it must be translated, should be translated as imperative because of the context. And those who translate the Bible, you know perfectly well that in order to translate not only the morphology but the syntax must be considered. And so the King James Version retains go as imperative because the translator based that decision in the context of, in the syntax of the structure of Matthew 28. Now, granted that that one is an imperative, even though the form is participle, okay? We have a very important missiological lesson for that. In order for us to be successful working in urban areas, we should not wait for people to come to us. If go should be accepted as imperative, we should what? We should go and reach them. And so, please take note, no, that that's the reason why go and make disciples have been retained as in the imperative form in the New King James Version. Now, I would like you to please take note of the word ethne. You know, this one is another word in Matthew 28. Yung bang nation. Do you remember that one? Make disciples of all nations. And the King James Version, I'm sorry, the New Testament Greek uses the word ethne. Ngayon yung ethnic, di ba? We use that one. Ethnic groups and that. Now, in the Greek Bible, in the Greek language, ethne is more broader than the way we understand the word ethnic today. It appears 151 times in the New Testament, and in both LXX, do you know that one? LXX is the Greek translation of the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, the meaning are the following: a multitude living together. So when there is a multitude of people living together, okay, and in most cases, in letter C, please take note, that these people are not really worshiping God. They don't have God, just like what you said, you know? There are many urban places where God is not there, you know, in their minds. You know? Now, if there are those who are living together, and most of them are foreign nations not worshiping God, and in the writings of Paul, that ethne oftentimes refers to Gentiles. And what is the Great Commission? Go make disciples of ethne, right? Nations. And these nations are having these characteristics. It is therefore reasonable to say that the ta ethne in the Great Commission has something to do with reaching the people living together who have not yet heard the gospel. And so our Great Commission is to go to those people. Okay, so we're going to connect that particular principle in our study of New Testament urban ministry. Okay, I don't have much time for this one, but for the empowerment of the Holy Spirit in urban ministry, Acts 1:8 uses the word theisgēs. You know Greek, some of you probably, but let us translate this one. The word earth in this particular passage came from the word gay in Greek word. And so in the LXX and in the New Testament, the word gay could be translated as inhabited earth, where people live. Okay? Our gospel should, when a person has been empowered by the Holy Spirit to bring the gospel, okay, all places inhabited by human beings should be rich. Not only the rural, but as well as the urban. Another word for that, please take note that in the signs of the last days, there is only one positive sign. And what is that? Ano yung pinaka, lahat negative, earthquake, famine, pestilences. But there is only one positive sign of the last days. And that is the what? The proclamation of the gospel, you know? And the word, the Greek word for world is oikumene. Okay, and another one is the one that we mentioned a while ago, ethnesin, and all of these words refer to the same idea, world or inhabited earth. Now, how to sum up all of this, I'm going to show you why the three angels' message is very important, is because those words that we have encountered are all embedded in the three angels' message. Diba? That's why our message is very important. The word gay, the word ethne, phule, glossa, laos, all of these words are all found in the three angels' message, implying that our message must be carried universally. Okay, that gives the strength, you know, to our New Testament basis. What then are the implications of the New Testament mandate to proclaim the everlasting gospel to all the earth, nation, tribe, tongue, and people? Okay, so I'm going to show you the challenges now. It has been mentioned by our president, but let me reiterate that these are the challenges if we follow the New Testament mandate, okay? According to the report of the United Nations, majority of the world's population was living in what? And where? Metropolitan cities, not in rural. Ano? So if we are going to bring the New Testament mandate into its fulfillment, okay, we should be very much interested and equipped working with those people, because many of them are not in the rural areas. Many of them are where? In the urban areas. So I am very much in total agreement with what we have heard a while ago, that we must train, siguro not only pastors, but even our ladies, our members to approach, you know, those who are living in the urban areas. Now, every nation on earth is undergoing urbanization that results to urbanism. Now, the word urbanism means adoption of urban lifestyle, okay? So, if a person is highly urbanized, it means that the person has adapted an urban lifestyle, and almost every nation on earth is undergoing such. Now, have you noticed this one? Even rural inhabitants, those who are living in rural places, because of the satellite broadcast, internet technology, they also adapted in some way or another the cultural influences of urban dwellers. And if you go to rural areas, even the mindset of people there are becoming what? Urbanized then, you know, because of the because they can access, you know, particular style of living, and so we have to meet the challenge. Now, cities, we have mentioned this one a while ago, are very complex. Okay, so we have to. But the most important thing here is that, based on the experience of Paul, for example, he found the city, or most of his cities he visited, as very tolerant as far as new ideas are concerned. So even though we say that cities are, people there are very, most of them don't believe in God, but when it comes to new ideas, okay, new concepts, many people in urban places are open to new ideas and concepts. Probably we can find that particular opening wedge in order to reach those people living in the city. You know? And also we have this one. We also have mentioned a while ago that if there are rich people in the city, many of them are also very what? Very poor. Diba? And so because of that, since cities are centers of human woes, that provides a great opportunity for them to accept the gospel. Now, this is what the problem is, no? This one came from our publication, and I have quoted this one in our slide now. In many countries or nations, I don't think Philippines is one of them, Adventist outreach has accomplished more in these small towns and rural areas outside the metropolitan regions. Am I right? So we have this one from one of our publications. Surveys have shown that in some major urban complexes, the majority of people have never heard of the Seventh-day Adventist Church and thus know nothing of the Three Angels message. Let me tell you one brief story. I was in Manila 2 weeks ago. And I visited one seminary, and many learned professors, PhDs, and so on, they interviewed me about my faith. I was surprised. How come that these learned professors in theology don't even know the basic of our Adventist faith? They are in the urban cities, you know? In urban city, I mean, Manila. And they said, what are your beliefs? Do you have the same belief just like what we have? These are evangelical professors. Now, if those learned teachers in those seminaries in Metro Manila have no knowledge about our belief, how much more are those ordinary people living in, you know, those who are working offices and companies? So we have a big challenge now, you know, that this is my proposal now. It seems urgent that developing a strategy to conduct urban ministry and mission should become what? One of our priorities. It should occupy the central issue, okay, and priority among Seventh-day Adventists members in churches. And so we have to be very, very interested, you know, doing our urban ministry work. Now, let me just share to you, maybe in a few minutes, you know, what particular practice of urban ministry the New Testament churches had during their time. Okay, let me show you a very concise, you know, no? First and foremost, the Bible, particularly the New Testament, has placed much emphasis in working with the cities. Okay, for example, more than 100 cities are mentioned in the Old and New Testament. We're going to look at the concordance and you're going to find them. And the word city, do you remember the word city? In Hebrew it's ir, ano? And in Greek it's poli or polis. It occurs 1,250 times. 1,090 times in the Old Testament and about 160 times in the New Testament. And so the word city is very, very common in the Bible. In most cases, the usages of the term refer to, especially the New Testament, evangelization. That's why when Paul visited one city after the other, okay, we can find the importance of cities in the Bible. Number two, we've also seen that the Great Commission of Christ includes urban ministry. Okay, so we have established that a while ago. I don't know if you agree with me. Now, please comment on this one. Previously, I was reading again and again the multiple gifts that God has given to His churches. Do you remember those passages? 1 Corinthians 12, Romans 12, Ephesians 4. What do they tell? They tell of gifts, right? Some are pastors, some are teachers, some are what?
Evangelists,
miracle workers. Now, it just came to my mind in my reading that it is obviously implied that the reason why God has given a lot of gifts in His church is because God designed His church to work in complex settings, right? Because all of these gifts, if applied in rural places, what's the need of some of those gifts, you know? But the fact that God gave a lot of gifts to the church is because one of the most important works of the church is to be done in what place? Cities. Kaya you check all those gifts, you know? And God has given the church all those gifts because God is preparing His church to work in urban areas, you know? So we don't have much time for this one. Now, what strategy did the church employ in order to reach people during their time? Remember, the early church believed that Christ would have come during their what? Their time. Just as we believe now, okay? And they were very eager to finish the work of God, to spread the gospel. But they had their own strategy. And what strategy? Look at the pages of the book of Acts and the writings of Paul. And you're going to see this principle. The gospel conquered the Roman world by penetrating its major cities. You can read it again and again. Acts, 1 Corinthians, 2 Romans, all of those writings of Paul. And you will find the same principle. Reaching the Roman world was through penetrating what? Yung mga major cities. Ano? And that's the strategy. What Paul did in his missionary journeys like this, ano? He went from city to city, finding ways to introduce the gospel in each city. Would you like to identify some cities? Corinth, Athens, what else? A lot, ano? And then, by establishing centers of Christian life in the important places, the gospel might then spread to the provinces. Have you noticed that one? So what Paul did was, he established church in the center, urban areas, and then from those centers, okay, the church, the gospel reached the fringes, yung mga, those remote areas within that region. The cities where he did plant churches were centers of Roman administration, of Greek civilization, of Jewish influences, or of some commercial importance. Paul's intention was to have the congregation situated in what place? City pa rin, ano? To be a center of light. The one reference, the book of Acts, chapter 19, verse 10. Now, Paul identified in each region the key cities. Let us recall them, ano? We have Antioch of Pisidia. Do you remember that one? This was at the Antioch of Syria. So, Antioch of Pisidia was located somewhere up north, ano? Paphos of Cyprus. Remember Cyprus? The home province of Barnabas. That's why when they went together as missionaries, Barnabas said, "We must begin in my own place." And they identified one city there, the Paphos. You can look at the map in the western tip of the island. It's a very prosperous city based on the standard. And they chose that one to be the point where gospel would spread throughout the island or a place. Philippi, Athens, Corinth, Ephesus, Macedonia, Caesarea, to carry out his mission. And finally, he landed as a prisoner in Rome. And what is Rome? This is the capital, no? A very urbanized area of the Mediterranean world, where during those times, he taught for 2 years, no? as a missionary, prisoner, but still was given liberty to proclaim the gospel during that time. So what I have in the map is the map of Paul's first missionary journey. Why is it significant? Because the following journeys, second and third, are just follow-up of what Paul did in the first. Okay, so have you noticed that one in the book of Acts? Now look at those circles. And those are the major cities established by Paul, no? Where churches were established. And look at the strategy, you know? So have you noticed Paul did not visit all the barangays? Wala siyang time noon, no? But he went to every major cities of these places in order to establish city churches. Okay? And from those churches, cities, you know, the gospel went to the very, remote places of that region. And so, we can follow the Pauline model of ministry, you know, by engaging ourselves in urban mission. And that's very important in our work. Okay, this is the second journey of Paul. You can see the distance, you know, and how he traveled. He visited again other places, but there we have additions. We have the addition of Athens, Corinth, and I would like to reiterate that if we have problem converting people today in urban areas, let's visit the experience of Paul in Corinth. Because of all the cities visited by Paul, Corinth was the yung stony ba yung anong term? Mabato, ano? It's very hard to win convert because most of them are immoral people. If you remember the temple of Aphrodite, you know, they worship a lot of God, the god of fertility, the goddess of fertility, where 1,000 sacred prostitutes were there to entertain worshipers. And in terms of moral, in terms of their social life, Corinth was one of the most challenging cities in Paul's ministry. But to make the story short, Paul was able to establish a thriving church in the community, in the city. Okay, even though Corinth is a very problematic church, you know, but still, members grew in grace and many became effective in doing their work. Okay, so another one is that, okay, so this is Paul's third missionary journey. You will find those cities, and again, visited by Paul, Philippi, and so forth and so on. So I hope that, now, I don't have time, but I have found in one source about 25 biblical strategies for urban ministry. I use the word biblical because our strategy must be based on the what? The Bible dapat. Not based on culture, not based on what other people say. So our strategy must be biblical. And since we don't have time to discuss all of them, probably I'm going to give you a copy of this one. So these are different strategies in order to establish churches and conduct evangelism in urban places. And some of them are in the Old Testament, and half of them are based on the New Testament. And so we're going to apply all of them in our ministry, probably selected part because we would like to adapt our strategy to a particular location or setting. So probably perhaps we can use them as our starting point, you know, to be successful workers or pastors in urban areas. Okay, now, marami yan eh, oh. There are so many. Okay, so I like number 25, okay, empowering churches and not networking them together so they did not become inward and isolated. Now, on the upper part, we have number 22, this is very important as well. Training. Ano? Because if you feel yourself like Michael Jordan, siya na ang forward, pwede siyang mag, ano nga yun, kung magbabasketball, pwede siyang mag-forward, pwede siyang mag-point guard, pwede siyang, for our ministry, it cannot be. Ano? So we need to train elders. And so part of the work of Paul when he was doing his urban ministry is to train urban leadership. And we have the sample there in the place of Ephesus. Okay. So we can also practice hospitality as our network. Okay, we can do that. Literature ministry could be done also as revealed by Paul's habit of writing a lot. And we don't know how many letters Paul wrote, probably 100 of them. Unfortunately, we have only how many in our Bible? Only 13 or 14 survived, but probably Paul might have written around hundreds of them, but all of them were lost. But the point is that Paul uses all means in order to reach people in the urban areas. So I'm going probably to distribute my handout this afternoon, but let me share to you to sum up my presentation is that we would like to share the fulfillment of Paul after he had done all of this. How many years did Paul serve the Lord? Would you like to guess? He was converted 35 after 1 year after the death of Stephen, and he was martyred around 64. Before the fall of Jerusalem, right? 66, something like that. So if you're going to compute about more than 30 years of ministry, okay, nasa retirement, okay, so more than 30 years, and we would like to according to the spirit of prophecy, when we get old, because we cannot avoid that, so there is no such medicine as fountain of youth. Merong gusto yung fountain of youth, that when you drink that medicine, instead of getting old, it will be reversed to getting young. Pero walang ganon. There is no such medicine for that. So whether we like it or not, all of us eventually will what? We'll get old. We cannot avoid that. Now, according to the spirit of prophecy, pag matanda na tayo, okay, and we are just in our rocking chair, yung pang pasilyon-silyon na lang, what will make us fulfilled as a person? The spirit of prophecy tells us that during that time in our older days, even though gusto natin mag-basketball, hindi na magawa, hindi na tayo makalabas, hindi na tayo makapag-jogging, but we are confined in our chair or maybe bed, the Holy Spirit will bring to our remembrance what we have done for the Lord in the past. Ipapaalala ng Holy Spirit yung naging instrument ka ng conversion, okay? But if we have not done something for the Lord, anong ipapaalala ng Holy Spirit sa atin?
Regrets.
So we will be full of regrets, We will be, we don't like to experience that. We want that when the time will come that we will be older than now, okay? That we will be tasting the yung bang joy of being part of God's work. And the Lord assures us that the Holy Spirit will bring to our remembrance all our efforts for God when we were younger. Papaalala ng Holy Spirit yun. And that will make us fulfilled and happy in our older days. Kaya may mga taong bitter. Why are they bitter? Kasi failure sila sa kanilang life. But when we do our work for the Lord, look at Paul, Even though he was about to die, he had the courage to say this one, Paul had the courage to say, in mighty signs and wonders, by the power of the Holy Spirit, so that from Jerusalem and round about Illyricum, this one is one of the places in the Roman Empire, what is his confidence now? What is his boasting? I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. And so the life of Paul is a life of fulfillment, because he has done his work as an able minister of the gospel. And so it is our prayer, that when we come to that point, if Christ will not come yet, that like Paul, we can say, from Metro Manila, Cavite, or in whatever places you will be assigned to, then what should be our pride, holy pride, It's what? I have fully preached the what? Tama ba yun? Holy pride, yung mga na? I have what? Fully preached the gospel of Christ. So praise God for giving us this wonderful opportunity of sharing His word.
All right, time for questions. Any question on the floor? Yes, Pastor Gonzalez.
I'm happy for the kind of presentation. I would just like to balance the approach. Of course, we consider Paul fitting for the urban because of his background.
Philosophy,
like he was for the background. But let us not forget Silas, Peter. They are tailored for remote places. And so you have mentioned something about basketball.
Yes.
In the teamwork,
yes.
There are people assigned to different areas.
Yes.
The center, the forward, the guard. Yes. And they have to do their part the way. Now, if you are not an active player anymore, you could act as the coach. in advisor, in a trainer. Uh-huh. Hindi yung pagpupo na lang. Correct. Kaya ako sila. Tapos ako nabas.
Correct. Correct.
So yung as a trainer, advisor din ako.
Correct. Right. So we are very much agree with that one. Remember that, who was that young guy that you mentioned a while ago? Si John Mark? Si John Mark. John Mark was a trained. Okay, as a matter of fact, he a little bit, backslided a little bit in the early beginning of Paul's work. Not in his faith, but in his work, because he committed himself as a worker. But because of patience on the part of the mentor, Barnabas, am I right? And so he became an effective minister after those long days of training. And so before the death of Paul, he said, bring John Mark with me, because he's been very effective in the work of God. And so, if a person is not yet trained, no, I think through patience on the part of the mentors, we can produce a lot of able ministers for urban places. Okay, so that's
that. I think Peter also was influential for John Mark, right? Yep.
This is a very nice perspective, especially for we have a lot of young students who will be changing the guard of those who are in older in the ministry. Now, you have mentioned in the last presentation about the legacy that we are going to make. I would like to make this comment because I have observed in the field right now that the gap between the older pastor and the younger pastor. It seems that today, younger pastor, because the environment that you are living is different, somewhat the environment of the work is totally different from those who have been in the past. It seems that I don't know what we call this mentality. But for those who are older, I have this experience. I was in Romblon, I am working in Romblon, and most of us are acquainted with Pastor Patrick.
Yes.
Yeah, he died already the other year, and every time we played tennis in the back of their house, because there is a court. And he always asked me and mentioned some of these names who have been his students before, like those who are now in the division, Pastor Yabut, Pastor Villanueva, and the rest. He's always asking me, where are these young these guys now? And I said, they are now in the division, in the high position, the denomination. And every time I mention this, Pastor Padre somewhat become emotional. And his eyes got teary. And I understand because what I can see in his self is that he become a part of this person. Because during our college days, he was the one who mentored us in the very hard part of the ministry. And so for young students, when you enter the ministry, this is a challenge that you will really try to make a hard work in order to have a legacy so that as the years pass by, when you get older, you have something to tell to your children that we have done this. So I think this is very good.
All right, thank you very much, your pastor.
Fahila.
Orly. Oh, see Orly, yeah? I didn't recognize. Oh, just one last question, right? Come on, sir, you.
This observation is in contrast to Pastor Orly. As I observe retirees, not most of them, but a lot of them, are becoming in conflict with their new workers.
Uh-huh.
When it comes to ideas, leadership, I don't know. So we can invite them also, maybe this kind of solution. Certainly, there is no one
really. All right. Thank you very much. For your active listening and at the same time participation. We now move to the next presenters.